to tonight's performance of Underline.
Where do you sit, on the bus or the tube?
Please ensure that all mobile phones are now turned off.
Are there any precautions you take for your safety? If so, why do you take them?
There will be no interval in tonight's performance.
How do your friends or family feel about you walking home alone?
If at any point you require to leave, please do so through the exit behind you.
What circumstances make you think of safety on public transport?
In case of an emergency, please leave through any exits and assemble outside the physics building.
What do you do to pass the time on a long journey?
Thank you, and we hope you enjoy the performance.
Do you find other passengers comforting?
So I can sit and see the whole city.
Well, I tried to talk with other people. And even sometimes, if you're on your own and there's children around with their mum or their dad, they might do something funny that makes you laugh, and then you end up chatting to them and talking about the child. There was a few scattered people around the bottom of the bus, and then a group of boys got with snowballs in their hands, and they just threw them out. One hit me in the back of the head, and one hit my son on his legs. He thought it was quite funny, but we did feel a bit scared. We did think, oh my God, what's the bus driver going to do? And he didn't send them off. He let them stay on. They stayed on for three more stops. I just kept saying to myself, why is the bus driver not sending these boys off the bus? Why is he not stopping the bus and letting them off? He never said a word, he just kept driving until they rang the bell. They didn't personally attack us or anything.
The bus driver also claimed to forget that on the bus and said they had to shout at them.
I don't know if other people think that. Well, I don't like to think of a woman being out on her own at night walking about. Men are okay. Probably that's the wrong answer, but I think men feel a lot safer than women do when they're on their own. Okay. But I do feel women feel better if they're with people at night. Maybe I'm old fashioned, I just think women shouldn't be on their own at night time.
Huh?
I don't like to be alone.
They're a bit too noisy. Cause they go teacher and it hurts my ears because they're very loud. Because they have high roofs, so I can sit and see the whole city.
But I still worry. Yeah. There's always a little niggle there saying, oh, how much longer is it going to take before she gets there? Yeah, but she hasn't texted me yet, and then I start panicking, and that's when you say to me, I'm not there yet, or, you know, we have to wait for the train.
Yeah.
You know, and then I start panicking. But it is self-inflicted. I know it's self-inflicted. They could give me a security guard of my own, and I still would worry.
Because they have high roofs, so I can sit and see the whole city.
unless it's during the day. I think at night, you know, I guess it's my fear of the unknown. But yeah, at night, when there's a few people, and if you're just by yourself, you're like, okay, nothing can happen here, because it's just me. But when there's a few people on the train as well, you think, oh, there's not a lot I can do right now, because, I don't know, it can be quite scary. I think if people were like shouting, like if there was a big argument on a train, I'd want to turn my music down, just so like I know what's going on, because there's not an awful lot I can do if a fight were to break out, because I'm quite a small guy. I think travelling at night in a near empty carriage, that's when there's like a few people, as in, yeah, like five or six other people, I guess. Unless it's during the day, I think at night when it's dark outside, you know, what like, I guess it's like fear of the unknown. But yeah, at night when there's a few people, and if you're just by yourself, you're like, okay, nothing can happen here because it's just me. But when there's a few people on the train as well, you think, there's not a lot I can do right now because, I don't know, it can be quite scary. I think if people were like shouting, like if there was a big argument on a train, I'd want to turn my music down, just so like I know what's going on, because there's not an awful lot I can do if a fight were to break out, because I'm quite a small guy.
I don't know. There's a good sense of like community feel to it. Like, everybody's going up there to do their own thing. Like, their own individual thing, but we're doing it together. I quite like that. Yeah, I prefer... I like being alone sometimes. And I think on a train journey, if I'm travelling by myself, I want to be, like, by myself as much as possible. So, like, I can sit down, put my headphones in, and not worry about anything else.
If we're out, we'll say, yeah, let me know you get home all right. So the other day, I was out. My friend Hannah says, text me when you get back.
I said likewise. So yeah, I don't think it's so much as, oh, he's walking home alone.
It's more, he's walking home alone. Let's make sure that he gets home all right.
I think, I don't know, it's like this institutionalism. Like, I'd walk home one way, they'd walk home the other. And I'd always think, like, it's no problem for me walking them home.
But a lot of them were insistent that they were completely fine and comfortable walking home themselves. So, if they are comfortable...
And that applies to a guy or a girl. If they're comfortable going home alone, that's fine with me.
No. Never personally. There was, it's like waiting at the platform, is that the same thing? Okay, there was, never personally, but I tried to, I was sat next to a woman going, getting on the same train as me. I was sat next to her on the platform, and there was a guy, and he was being like very, very close and quite invasive of her space. I could tell that she was like really, really uncomfortable. This again was another incident where I had to turn down my music. In fact, I think I just turned off because I wanted to make sure I could kind of like tell what was going on, but still just kind of looking straight forward, but seeing it in the periphery. I could tell that she was like really, really uncomfortable. When he went to like touch her shoulder, she kind of shuddered. Like I got up and I tried to like force his attention towards me. I don't know if he was malicious, but I just think he was really drunk. But when I can tell that other people are really uncomfortable, because she did look absolutely terrified about what was happening, I thought I could probably handle him talking to me and rambling at me. So when he started talking to me, I kind of like walked with him down the platform towards the security desk and just gave her space. So I guess that like in that sense, never personally feeling taking somebody else's personal threats and like shifting it away from them, almost like a superhero. So I think there is a difference
between feeling safe and feeling comfortable.
I think safe is being away from any danger or harm.
And I think comfort is being in a place where you, I think comfort is like...
It is safe, but there's so much more to it.
It's difficult to say without just saying that you're comfortable.
Me and my friends, we studied abroad in Galway, Ireland, and one weekend we were just really bored. We looked at the cheapest tickets somewhere, and they were to Prague. And I think that was also the first trip that I'd ever planned from a European country to another European country.
National Rail.
So it was super cool kind of seeing how easy it was, because it's not easy in America thinking about travel. And planning the bus rides, and it was two guys and me and another female. So we were kind of a smaller group, but still had the gender mix.
Because I find it very difficult as someone who is visually impaired to find the correct train.
So throughout that whole time, we took a bus to the airport, then we flew to Prague, and then in Prague we did every kind of transportation I think imaginable. And a lot of walking too.
Yes, I've gotten on the wrong train. Someone had to help me get on the right train.
And then that was fun because I think I always felt safe even, which was interesting, and I didn't realize that until I was traveling with only females that I realized how much I didn't think about safety as long as other males were there.
They don't seem to mind at the moment. I think they would have when I was younger, but as I got older they sort of just, you know, I just text when I'm leaving and it's fine.
They don't like it. My dad really doesn't like it. I haven't made many mistakes yet in that area, but we actually have a friend that we live with who has gotten robbed twice, and like we just were convinced it's her because she's just ditzy and she is never aware of what's going on.
Getting there on time, making sure I leave enough time, and yeah, I always have battery in my phone and money if I need to for a cab or something.
Get to the right place and look like I know what I'm doing.
80s and 90s classics, such as Tiffany, Rick Astley, and a bit of Take That.
So I have more of like my like Adele, my Andre Days, and like those like kind of soothing voices. And then my other one's like straight Beyonce.
Hold up, they don't love you like I love you. Slow down, they don't love you like I love you. Back up, they don't love you like I love you. Step down, they don't love you like I love you.
Now that there's Wi-Fi on the train, I don't really do much thinking. I really just sort of just check my emails and play on Facebook. It's nice because before you did have to sort of, you had that spare time to think about things, but now you can just sort of unwind.
Usually don't mess up. Like I'm someone who like I go over again and again in my head like, all right, I'm inward bound, I'm getting off at this station to switch over to the red line, like blah, blah, blah.
Just because it's a nice sort of, you don't have to, I think before you had sort of 45 minutes of either people watching, which I struggle with, or, you know, just thinking about things that are like you're struggling with, or, you know, money issues, or, but with, when you've got your phone, you can just sort of unwind and escape from all that. Silly things like I wouldn't leave my bags. You know, I still hold my bag close to me because people, like a lot of my friends worry about if you know, mobile phones being taken from you. There's a lot of that going on again at the moment.
I zip in my purse always. I have like a big long chop bag and I never zip it here because it's usually my gym bag, but if I'm going to Boston, I bring it to like put stuff in that I buy. And I never used to zip it until my mom was like, do you know how easy it is? Like if someone sees an open bag, just like grab it, take anything out of it. Definitely when I'm alone, or if it's something new, or late at night doesn't always bother me until I have to walk alone. Like I don't mind being on a train late at night with other people. It's always interesting, but then it's once I get off and like have to walk to my car to like drive the rest of the way, that I'm like very uneasy about walking alone in like a carport.
Yes, when I was younger, I had a man flash me on the tube late at night, and there was no one else on the train.
So hot. Oh,
can't say more seats because they can't make any more seats. And really, the trains come through really quickly, so... Well, I don't know how they can make it any better. But air conditioning, definitely.
Recliner chair, three-person sofas. Just bigger. A bit more leg room and a bit more weight from the chairs.
Air conditioning in summer and better heating in winter. No people there? aircon. Pillows, blankets, fairy lights, candles, incense. I think probably having more seats available. Oh, and also, when they say there are quiet carriages, there should be quiet carriages. We're no one making stupid phone calls. Air conditioning. Come for your seats.
If I'm on a train at night time and I feel uncomfortable, I might put my keys between my fingers, but that's... If I feel like someone's following me or something, other than that, maybe put my headphones in, but I won't be playing any music. So no one will talk to me. If someone hears talking, I can still hear them.
An EpiPen. I always have my EpiPen for some of my peanuts. And I'm allergic to peanuts, I'll be doing that. Then they'll be like, why is he having an allergic reaction? It's like, you've got a peanut, mate. Rejected by the whole process.
I put my bag in front of me, mate. That's me because I'm worried my phone might get stolen. Make sure I've got my phone on me, which is
see that, and I'm not, I hate being one of those bystanders on public transport, you know what I mean? Like, so much can happen, and people just sit there and, you know, only care about judging. That frustrates me. Yeah, so the guy was, he obviously didn't have the right fare or anything, and he was arguing with the bus driver, and the bus driver was either Pakistani, Bangladeshi or Indian or something, and he started calling them a towel head and all this stuff, and I was like, okay, this is not cool. I just stepped in there. Ended up pushing him out of the bus, but that, I don't do that normally. You started to retaliate, obviously, initially verbally, but after I just, you know, had enough of just... With me, my own, like, you know, cultural kind of ethnic identity, and how, especially after the whole Brexit thing, like, people could be more prone to, you know, racially charged verbal attacks or anything, just from dressing the way they dress. That might not necessarily happen to me, but I feel that it could happen to other people within my ethnicity. As well as that, girls as well. I mean, all my really, really close friends are all girls, and I treat them like my little sisters, so I'm really protected. And then when I just think of, like, I haven't got any sisters of my own, they're like my sisters. But when I think of, like, on a general scale, like, how many young girls, if they could just be going out for a night out or something, how many guys, you know, the filthier ones and stuff, would try something when they're on the train by themselves, just maybe even going home to see their parents for the first time, you know. When you're on transport, you really, all around London, you really start to think like every person you meet has like a different, has their own life and their own story and etc. It sounds really wacky, but like the way it is, you know, and it's just the whole circumstances, I don't know. It is genuinely the whole, like, if guys are drunk or anything like that, they say things they don't mean to say, not mean to say. They say things they shouldn't say, and they do things they shouldn't do, whether that's targeted towards ethnic minorities or women, you know, that does make me concerned. The only time I move seats is if there's, like, if I'm squished in between two people. But nah, I've seen people do it with me, though. Yeah, people, some usually older white women. I'm not saying that to badmouth the white man. I'm just saying that's how it's happened. And then I was going home on the tube, and I had a suitcase and everything. And this girl comes up on the train, she was white, and she's like really panicking and stuff like that. I think because she got on the wrong train and her like friend or boyfriend was still on the platform, and she's like, oh, I don't know where to go. Does anyone know where this station is, like Euston station is? And you know, nobody kind of answered her. And she asked again, she was really panicking. And then I took my headphones out. And by the time I took my headphones out, this other Muslim guy, Terry Muslim, because of the beard and everything, came up and started talking to her and helping her. He said, it's this station, you need to take this route. And then she was still panicking, like, oh, I don't know where to go. I got up and I talked to her, it's like, if you want, I can stay with you, get on the train till you get on the platform and stuff. Like, don't worry, it's going to be okay. Basically, just consoling her. And then, after that whole incident happened, she left on the next stop, shook the other guy's hand, and I just thought to myself, like, I'm Muslim, he's Muslim. We're both brown, both got beards. But we were the ones who helped this girl. And there was a bunch of other, you know, English, typical, stereotypical, just white Caucasian males, females on this train that ignored this girl. And it just dawned on me that the media kind of portrays us, the Muslim stuff, to be bad guys, the ones to watch out for on public transport. But on this day, we were the ones who helped this girl when no one else would. Yeah, as soon as I walk on, not every single time, but I tend to see, like, in the central areas, people don't really notice. They're all in suits, they're getting on with their daily lives. But when you go outside of Central, more people start to look at you. Yeah, just look me up and down, see what I'm about. If I got a backpack, get more loads. And then one time actually, not one time, it was a lot, like, I go into my bag and I notice more people looking at me. And they expect, I don't know what they expect me to pull out, but that I pull out a Shakespeare book most of the time. And it's, I don't know, it's just like really interesting to see, like, I'm the one who's actually pulling out English literature book, you know, I'm not pulling out a Quran or 100 ways to bomb 50 people, like, it's still, yeah. I understand the caution and frustration, because even me sometimes, I'm not even gonna lie, when I was younger, when people, other guys dressed in traditional dress, the skull cap and the beard and backpacks used to come on the train, I would, like, give them a second glance, because, and that's terrible, because it's just the way we've been conditioned to think. And it shouldn't be that way. And when you're by yourself, or all these things, like, you become more aware of them. And then when I was in the airport, I was like, that was just like unsettling feeling in my stomach until I got on the plane. When I got on the plane, I was fine. But yeah, that was the first time I got nervous. And I think it was down to the whole recent terror attacks that got me feeling that way. And like, I was for a little bit, like literally until we took off. That's probably because I'm just used to flying. Yeah, I was okay after that. But in terms of other public transport, yeah, it's just the way that the media kind of conditions you. Understandably so, to some extent, when people of my own, you know, religion or ethnicity come on the tube and stuff with backpacks, I have the second glance at them. And it's unfortunate, but I can't say it's not true. And I can't say it's not happening, because that would just be a lie. You do get some deluded people. Like, the people that do that, they're not real Muslims, you know? And I think everyone just needs to realize that a bit more.
But you shouldn't listen to the media. here about being paranoid about everything, because then you can't really live your life. Because there are going to be times when you're out by yourself and you're drunk and it's a bit scary, but as long as you've, you know, told someone where you are or you're with someone else, then I think it's fine.
Really unsafe, and kind of the only time is in my hometown, which is like tiny, everyone knows everyone. So to cut a short story short, I was with some, I went out to meet my best friend who said, oh, come to this pub, like loads of people we know are there. So I turn up and there's loads and loads of guys there, all from, all like 1 year, 2 year below me, and unfortunately one of them, their friend had died. So they were kind of having drinks in celebration of his life. Some of the guys we ended up having like a really nice night with them, having a drink, laughing, talking. I didn't really know them very well. I thought they were really nice guys. And then my best mate went home with her boyfriend who was there, leaving me with these guys. And she was like, oh, do you want me to walk you home? But he lives in like a completely different direction to me, so I was like, no, it's fine. Literally, as soon as she left, one of the guys like came up to me and kind of just like grabbed my arse, and I was like, well, that's not okay, and kind of pushed him off of me. And then I feel like that was the hall pass, like everyone was just like, oh, I want my bit. And it's not even me, like I'm not trying to act big-headed, it's just they were all really drunk, and I know that's not an excuse. It's just they were all kind of trying to get their two cents in, like, and I mean not all of them, there were probably about eight of them, but like I know three of them grabbed me, one of them repeatedly, and I laughed the first one off, just as like, don't do that again, that's not very nice, and then it happened another few times, and I was starting pacing it, trying to get home, just like, I don't really know what I got myself into. I didn't expect this to happen. And then he's getting shit yelled at me down the street, like, oh, come back here with your fine arse or something like that. Well, they call me a yat. Do you know what a yat is? It means young and tight, and I literally wanted to vomit. Like, it was so disgusting, derogatory behaviour, which they thought were a compliment, which was driving me insane. So yeah, they were like, oh, gonna fuck you, blah, blah, blah. Not all of them saying it, but a lot of them did just stand and watch while their mates yelled at me down the street. Yes, that was fun. So I got tired of it, I turned around and I said, you know what? Like, I've been sat with you guys all night. I thought you guys were nice. And now you're, as soon as my best mates left, like, you know I'm more vulnerable, I'm by myself, and you're just yelling shit at me for no reason. Like, I haven't done anything. I haven't suggested I was interested in you whatsoever. So I don't see where this is coming from. And then, yeah, one of the guys tried to grab me again, and I just kind of burst into tears. And then the nice guy came over and was like, oh, leave the yat alone. And I was like, don't call me a yat. Like, I understand what he was trying to do. I do appreciate what he was doing. It's just, it was still ingrained in this whole misogynistic shit. And I just still felt like shit after he said that, even though he was trying to help. And then another one of the guys did actually help, because he was like, kind of like, like, let's try and get you home, like, do you want me to call a taxi for you? But, I don't know, I was just like, no, I'm just going to leave it, because at that moment I felt even more threatened. I was just like, well, I'm not going to get a cab with a random guy now, no chance. So I probably should have called someone to be like, yeah, come pick me up, Mum, or something, but I don't know. I don't know why I didn't. And then I called
called Georgia, my best mate, and told her what happened like minutes after she left, and just like cried and ran up to my home. Yeah, I don't particularly like people following me home, surprisingly. That wasn't a nice experience, especially in your hometown where you're supposed to feel safe. I don't want to meet any of them again. At that moment, in that situation, I felt like quite ashamed. The fact that like these people aren't white men, like van stereotypes. They aren't older guys, they're young guys that have grown up with this mentality that it is okay to talk like that. Like some of them weren't even 18. Like I don't know what was running through their head. Like has society told them that this is the best way to pick up girls? If so, it's so badly informed. Like, it was all so ridiculous. Like when I was walking home, like, oh, I wanna fuck you, blah, blah, blah. And as soon as I said no, I was like a filthy slut that wasn't even good looking anyway. Like either way, I don't think they realised what they said was an insult. Like yelling at me, telling me you want to fuck me, is not a compliment by any means. Like I've sat with you for probably like 3 hours having, well, I wouldn't say very intelligent conversation, but like having a laugh. Like, do I not have more to offer as a woman? Is that all they were talking to me for? Because they thought maybe at the end of the night they'd get lucky. Is that what it was to them? It's just really shitty. And I mean, there are guys that aren't like that, but I feel like a lot of it is just ingrained. I think, one of the ways I think we should move forwards, not personally how I should, is to just like not normalize it. Like everyone I've ever met that's a woman has a story of being harassed by a guy. Whether that's like walking home being yelled out the window at, or like if I hear someone tell that story, from my perspective now is to just not make them one feel like, oh it happened but it's fine. Like if you're upset about it, you deserve the right to be upset. Whether it was one guy who thought it was harmless or loads of guys who had even worse intentions. And just break this thing of a woman should just be silent and take, because there are loads of people that have gone through even worse shit, and just brush it off. And I don't know how we can move forwards, because every woman has experienced